Now let's look at the concept of IND-AS 103. When I talk about IND-AS 103, I'm particularly looking at this aspect relating to business combination. When I discuss about a business combination, it is nothing but acquiring a control over another enterprise is called as business combination. So when I use the word business combination, it simply means acquiring control over another enterprise. When do you say that you acquired control over the other enterprise? Control definition, which we have discussed as far as IND-AS 110 is concerned. That means what? So basically, when an enterprise has a power over the investee, is subjected to variable returns from the investee, and has an ability to use the power to influence the return that they can extract from the investee. The conditions we have put up. I said there is a power over the investee. They are exposed to variable returns from the investee, and they have an ability to use this power to influence the returns which are received from the investee. If these three conditions are satisfied, then you can say that an enterprise has a control over another enterprise. The day on which the transaction which gives rise to the control over another enterprise is discussed as far as the standard is concerned. Now, subsequent to the transaction has occurred, when there is a control existing on each balance sheet date, I'll apply consolidated procedures, which we already know as far as IND-AS 110 is concerned. So what is IND-AS 103 talking about? It is a single point accounting. What is that single point? The date on which control has been acquired. The day on which the control is acquired, you will have to account for it as per IND-AS 103 business combination. Clear? So let's see what business combination involves. Business combination, IND-AS 103, talks about the laying down the principles of recognizing for the acquiring control over another enterprise. Generally, control means at least 50% of voting power. So if X, an acquirer, is taking hold of at least 50% of voting power in Y, then he is said to be having a control over Y. The date on which this acquisition has happened, it should be recorded as per IND-AS 103. Clear? Now, we come across a situation where we have a reverse acquisition. Where, let's say, for suppose, there is a transaction between X and Y. I'll help you with an example, guys, here. Let me take an example to help you understand this concept. Let's say, for example, there is a transaction between two enterprises, X and Y. Okay. Let's say, for example, Y is transferring its net assets to X. As an exchange, X has to pay consideration. Let's say this purchase consideration is in the form of equity shares of X. Purchase consideration this purchase consideration in the form of equity shares in X, let's say 15,000 equity shares in X were directly issued to the shareholders of Y. Instead of Y Limited, they are directly issuing the purchase consideration to shareholders of Y. Before this transaction, the actual number of equity shares in X were, let's say, 10,000. So what happened here? The shareholders of X were holding 10,000 shares in X, but now X has given purchase consideration to Y in a form of its equity shares to the extent of 15,000. So what happened now? Now, if you observe, after acquisition, in X Limited, the total equity shares is how much? Total equity shares are 25,000. Out of this 25,000, 15,000 equity shares are held by shareholders of Y. That is, more than 50%. Therefore, here Y Limited, though is whose net assets are taken over by X, you need to understand that it is the shareholders of Y which will now start controlling X. Therefore, it might look as if like actually this person who is X Limited is actually the acquirer. But if you observe this sense that the shareholders of Y are ultimately getting more than 50% in X, so X is not the acquirer, but X should be considered as an acquiree. Then who is the acquirer in this case? The acquirer is Y Limited in this case, because it is the shareholders of Y Limited which are acquiring control or more than 50% of voting power in X Limited after the transaction of business combination has occurred. This is a simple situation which leads to a reverse acquisition, where sometimes this can be very tricky to identify who is the acquirer and who is the acquiree. Clear? So in this example, the same example which I have given there, I'm saying X is the acquiree and Y is the acquirer, unlike it actually looks like. Actually, Y is the acquiree. Now, this determination of cost of control we have already seen before, where cost of control is computed on the day on which the parent enterprise has acquired control over the subsidiary. How do you calculate? Cost of control is about determination of goodwill or bargain purchase. So that is cost of investment in subsidiary added by the non-controlling interest on the date of acquisition compared with the fair value of identifiable net assets in the subsidiary on date of acquisition. This will result in either goodwill or bargain purchase. This is exactly the similar computation that we have seen even as per Ind AS 110. If you look at the same thing we have done under Ind AS 110, where there is multiple dates of acquisition. In such case, what I did? Cost of investment in subsidiary plus fair value of investment in subsidiary already held by holding company plus NCI on date of acquisition. That is compared with fair value of net assets in the subsidiary on the date of acquisition, which might result either in goodwill or bargain purchase. This is ascertained as per Ind AS 103. Have a look at it, this computation. This computation is something that we have already seen as per Ind AS 110. Have a good view of this computation. If you remember, this was the same computation which we have done as per Ind AS 110. And there itself, I told you this is as per your Ind AS 103 and not as per Ind AS 110. Hope you're done with that. How do they recognize the transaction? Look at the transaction being recorded. If I'm preparing the transaction in the books of the acquirer in his books of accounts will record the entry as investments in acquiree account debit to bank. That's a simple transaction. I buy shares in Infosys. What will I record? Investment in shares of Infosys account debit to bank. But upon business combination, how do I record? I'm taking over the assets and liabilities. So therefore, I'll have to derecognize the investment and I have to recognize the assets and liabilities of the acquiree. So net assets of the acquiree account debit, either goodwill or cap bargain purchase will arise to bank to NCI. NCI will be recognized as a liability to the extent the consideration is paid in bank, credited to the bank. This is the combination entries or the entry to be recorded whenever a business combination arises in the books of acquirer. Have a look at the entry. Yes, guys, so let's continue. What are the steps involved in a business combination? Whenever there is a business combination, I have to involve 6 steps to derive at the balance sheet on the date of business combination. The first step is to identify who is the acquirer and who is the acquirer. Generally, it is evident from a problem of who is the acquirer and who is the acquirer. But there are stages, there are cases where I've given you a reverse acquisition where the identification of acquiree and acquirer might be a little difficult or might get a little complicated. So, but in general sense, it is a very simple, straightforward situation of identifying an acquirer and an acquiree. Once you identify the acquirer and acquiree, I'll have to identify the date on which the controlling interest was acquired. That is the date on which Ind AS 103 should be applied. That is the date of acquiring controlling interest by the acquirer in the acquiree. That is the second date, which is evident from any problem that you find. Number three, then you start determining what is purchase consideration. What do you mean by purchase consideration? It is a consideration paid by the acquirer to the shareholders of acquiree. Consideration paid by the acquirer towards the shareholders of acquiree is called as purchase consideration. When I say shareholders, such purchase consideration could be paid either to the equity shareholders or to the preference shareholders. Guys, if your preference shareholders are classified as equity only, this purchase consideration to preference shareholders will get included in step 3. If your preference share capital is classified as a financial liability, why does it get classified as financial liability? Because it has a fixed maturity date. It gives rise to an obligation for the enterprise to pay cash or to an obligation to deliver cash on a particular maturity date. In such situation, preference share capital should not be recognized in equity, but should be recognized as a financial liability. Guys, this discussion we'll have in a much more elaborate sense when we are discussing about Ind AS 109. Clear? In Ind AS 32, we have the discussion between equity and financial liability, where we come across this discussion. But I am saying, if you have a particular preference share which is classified as equity, only then that preference share consideration paid to preference shareholders should be included in step 3. Then your step 4 is the most important step, where you identify the net assets of the acquiree at their fair value, where you determine the fair value of each asset and each liability as it exists in the acquiree, and that should be the total net assets or total identifiable net assets in the acquiree. Step 5 is determination of cost of control to identify a goodwill or bargain purchase. And finally, we draw the balance sheet. This is a 6-step approach, out of which the first two are identifiable right from the face of the question itself, where we know who is the acquirer and who is the acquiree, and what is the date on which the controlling interest is acquired. These two are already available. So fundamentally, I have to do 3 steps before I draft a balance sheet. Number 1, determine the purchase consideration. Number 2, determine the fair value of net assets in acquiree which were acquired under business combination. Finally, I determine what is the cost of control. It is identifying either goodwill or bargain purchase in the transaction before I draft a balance sheet on the date of business combination. Like I told you, purchase consideration is paid to the equity shareholders or the preference shareholders of the selling company or the acquiree. So such kind of consideration paid to the shareholders of acquiree should be considered as purchase consideration. In what way does the purchase consideration gets discharged? The acquirer to purchase the shares of selling company or the acquiree could either issue consideration in the form of cash, could issue for a consideration in the form of some assets, could issue consideration in the form of securities in acquirer's company, which is debt securities or bonds, or can also be in the form of equity investment in acquirer. So acquirer, while taking over the entire shareholders or shareholding in acquiree, can issue their own equity shares, or can they issue debentures or bonds, or they can issue an asset, or they can issue cash. Whatever it is, this consideration is called as purchase consideration. To determine purchase consideration, that is nothing but your step 3, we have 3 methods of identifying. Purchase consideration can be computed using net payments method, net assets method, or intrinsic value method. What are these 3 methods, and how do I determine purchase consideration under each of these 3 methods? And also, one should know when to apply each of these methods. When to apply is very important. Remember, my first preference is always net payments method. I will identify purchase consideration by net payment method if purchase consideration is given in the form of fixed sum of money. A acquires B Limited by paying 10 lakhs. Very simple. Straightforward, I got them. A acquires B Limited by paying 10 lakhs. Over. Case is over. So 10 lakhs is your purchase consideration. That is net payments method. Or the purchase consideration is determined in the form of number of equity shares to be issued by the acquirer by the acquirer to the acquiree. X Limited takes over Y Limited by issuing 10,000 shares in X Limited at a price of 25 rupees per share, where purchase consideration is given in the form of number of equity shares to be issued by the acquirer to the acquiree. Second situation, why I use net payments method. Third one, where the purchase consideration is given in the form of an exchange ratio. X Limited is taking over Y Limited by exchange of their shares in the ratio of 5 shares for every 7 shares held in Y Limited. So that means by taking over 7 shares in Y Limited, X Limited will issue 5 shares. 5 by 7 is your exchange ratio. So therefore, if I want to apply net payments method in computation of purchase consideration, then the purchase consideration should either be given in the form of fixed sum of money, or fixed number of equity shares issued to the acquiree, or where the consideration is expressed in the form of an exchange ratio of shares between the acquiree and the acquirer. In these three cases, I will apply net payments method. Under net payments method, the purchase consideration is equal to the fixed amount or is equal to the number of shares issued by the acquirer multiplied by issue price per share. Clear? Look at it. Only if the consideration is specified as a fixed amount or by fixed number of shares or given in the form of exchange ratio. X Limited takes over Y Limited at for a consideration of 10 lakhs. X Limited takes over Y Limited by issuing 10,000 equity shares at 25 rupees each. X Limited takes over Y Limited by exchanging its shares in the ratio of 3 shares for every 5 shares held. All these are examples of net payments method in determining purchase consideration. Then what is net assets method? Like you know, net assets is nothing but assets minus outside liabilities. Correct? It is nothing but net assets minus outside liabilities. But here, under per determination of purchase consideration, your net assets method put up like this. Purchase consideration is equal to assets measured at fair value minus outside liabilities measured at settlement values plus the amount of goodwill. This technique of measuring purchase consideration by net assets method will be only applied if you cannot determine purchase consideration as per net payments method. Only if you cannot determine purchase consideration by net payments method, I think that is a correction required. If the purchase consideration cannot determine by net payments method, then I'll apply net assets method. Where under net assets method, purchase consideration is equal to assets minus outside liabilities plus goodwill, where assets are measured at realizable values and liabilities are measured at settlement values. Clear? Guys, before I get into your intrinsic value method, I want you to look at net assets method once again. If you're comfortable with net assets method, I'll move into intrinsic value method. I wanted you people to look at net assets method once again, because your intrinsic value method, that is the third method in determining purchase consideration, is more or less aligned with net assets method itself. The third method of determining purchase consideration, which is as per intrinsic value method, is more or less aligned with net assets method. Because an intrinsic value per share of a company is determined by using the mathematical application of net assets attributable to equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares. That is the formula for intrinsic value. What did I say? Net assets attributable towards equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares. Now, when I say net assets, is it different from net assets attributable to equity shareholders? Yes. Your net assets attributable to equity shareholders is nothing but the net assets which you have determined as per part 2 or your step 2, where you have determined assets minus outside liabilities plus goodwill minus liability to preference shareholders. What is your liability to preference shareholders? To pay out his capital, to pay out the dividends which are payable in arrears, or to pay out any premium on redemption of preference shares. These three combined are called as liability to preference shareholders. If your liability to preference shareholders is reduced from the value of net assets, then we determine something called as net assets attributable to equity shareholders. Such net assets attributable to equity shareholders, if it is divided by number of equity shares, we get something called as intrinsic value method. For determining purchase consideration under intrinsic value method, the number of shares issued by the acquirer should be multiplied by the issue price per share. How do I identify number of shares issued by acquirer? Number of shares issued by acquirer is nothing but number of shares in inquiry multiplied by exchange ratio. What is exchange ratio? Exchange ratio is intrinsic value per share in inquiry divided by intrinsic value per share in acquire by acquirer. How do I determine intrinsic value? Net assets attributable to equity shareholders divided by number of equity shares, where net assets attributable to equity shareholder is equal to net assets minus liability to preference shareholders, which is given as preference share capital plus preference dividend plus any premium on redemption of preference shares. Guys, before I move into from next topic, I would still want to stick with intrinsic value method. And let me tell you something, that in absence of intercompany holdings, I'll repeat, in absence of intercompany holdings, your intrinsic value method purchase consideration is equal to net assets in acquiry. In case there is no intercompany holdings, my intention is that, I'm continuing to say that, purchase consideration under intrinsic value method is equal to the net assets of the acquiry. Now, I would want you people to see what is given out here. Try to perform your functions and determine how I said that. How did I say that? I am saying the purchase consideration is equal to net assets of acquiry. You determine how do you get that value. Use your pen and paper and try to determine how do I get purchase consideration is equal to net assets. One minute, I'll start solving. By the time I want you people to determine it. I made a statement saying that under intrinsic value method, purchase consideration is equal to net assets of acquiry. I want you people to determine. Go ahead, guys. I'll determine for you. I'll tell you how I get that answer. I said purchase consideration under intrinsic value method is equal to number of equity shares to be issued by the acquirer multiplied by issue price per share. If you look at the formulas which I gave you earlier, I said number of shares to be issued by acquirer is equal to number of shares in inquiry, multiplied by exchange ratio. This should be multiplied by issue price per share, which is nothing but intrinsic value of acquirer. Again, I gave you a formula for exchange ratio. So I again write it. Number of shares in inquiry multiplied by intrinsic value. I'm writing it as IV, guys. I don't want to write the entire thing. Intrinsic value of inquiry divided by intrinsic value of acquirer, right? This is what your exchange ratio is, multiplied by intrinsic value of acquirer, which is the issue price per share. By simple math, intrinsic value of acquirer should get cancelled, one in the numerator and the other one in the denominator. So now I will be left out with number of shares in inquiry multiplied by, what is intrinsic value of inquiry? Intrinsic value of inquiry is nothing but net assets attributable to equity shareholders. In inquiry divided by number of equity shares in inquiry. This is the formula for intrinsic value of inquiry. Again, I can cancel number of equity shares, Therefore, what is your PC? Therefore, purchase consideration is equal to net assets attributable to equity shareholders in inquiry. This is exactly what I was telling. I told you, right? Your net assets, your purchase consideration will be exactly equal to the net assets in the inquiry. This is how I calculate. Guys, this derivation which I've done is only correct if there is no intercompany holding. What are these intercompany holdings and how do I determine them? Remember, whenever I get this concept of intercompany holdings, the most predominant one that I find, is acquirer already holding shares in inquiry. In this case, when you have acquirer holding shares, already holding shares in inquiry, this gives rise to multiple dates of acquisition. In this case, that means acquirer already holds 20%. Now is purchasing 50%. So the total holding became 70%. In such cases, the second date of acquisition should be the date on which they have acquired control. The second date on which they have acquired control, I have to apply Ind AS 103. In such cases, what will change? Only your cost of control will change. What do you do with respect to cost of control? Whatever investments were already held in the inquiry, they should be measured at fair value. Now, the cost of acquisition of 50% plus fair value of the 20% already held plus NCI balance 30% should be compared with fair value of net assets to derive either goodwill or bargain purchase. But whatever is the difference between the carrying value of investment and fair value of investment of which was already held in the inquiry, the difference should be transferred to fair value reserve. Here, the second type of intercompany holding is where the inquiry has certain shares in the acquirer. Whenever your inquiry has certain shares in acquirer, remember, Companies Act says the subsidiary cannot hold shares in its parent. Small exception, he said, if the subsidiary has acquired these shares before it became a subsidiary of the parent, that means subsidiary initially held 10% in the parent company. Parent company subsequently has acquired more than 50% shares in subsidiary. Only in that circumstance, subsidiary can hold shares in parent. Otherwise, your subsidiary should never hold shares as far as the parent enterprise is concerned. Therefore, this concept of acquiring holds and holding shares in acquirer does not emerge. Clear? It does not emerge as far as business combination is concerned. Clear logic now? So only one intercompany holding where acquirer already holds shares in inquiry, and on such cases, I will apply the concept of the determination of cost of control or for multiple dates of acquisition. Clear? What do you mean by contingent consideration? Contingent consideration means such amount of consideration which is payable on occurrence or non-occurrence of a future event. That future event occurs after the date of business combination. But you are agreeing today. I'll put it like this. On the date of acquisition, the acquiree's business is making a net profit of 8%. The acquirer has paid some purchase consideration and he said that the existing purchase consideration will increase by 10% if the net profit of the acquirer's business in the next 3 years increases to 10%. Today's net profit percentage of 8, if it becomes 10% within the next 3 years, then the purchase consideration which I paid now will increase by 10%. So that is contingent consideration. Guys, if you think this is, sir, I've never come across this logic only. Wait, I'll tell you. This is very common as far as footballing world is concerned. Football world outside India, because India, our football world is very limited. We don't have so much of prominence to the sport. But if you go outside India, let's say I have a player like Lionel Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo. Let's say Messi, who is today owned by Barcelona, that means Barcelona owns the services of Messi on the field. If Barcelona is selling Messi to another club, Let's say I sold it to a club, let's say in London. So what happens? This London club is basically agreeing terms with Barcelona to acquire the services of this player, Lionel Messi. They'll say, I will give you $80 million today or £80 million today, plus I will give you an additional $20 million if, with the help of Lionel Messi, I will be able to win the Champions League. If I will be able to win a particular competition, then I will give you extra $20 million, which is future. It is an uncertain future event which is giving rise to a consideration for a transaction which already occurred. Then such consideration is called as contingent consideration, and this is common. This is very common. So what he says, whenever there is a contingent consideration, it should be measured at its fair value. It should be measured at its fair value. And by measuring it at fair value, I will add it to the purchase consideration on the date of acquisition. So acquirer shall recognize the acquisition date fair value of the contingent consideration as a part of consideration transferred in exchange for the acquiry. The acquirer shall classify the obligation to pay contingent consideration either as a liability or equity in accordance with Ind AS 32. Let's say they said contingently, I will issue 10,000 shares in future, equity instrument. Let's say if I say I will give you 10 lakhs in future if certain condition is met, then it is an obligation. So depending on obligation or equity, it will be classified, but it should be measured at fair value and included in purchase consideration. Clear? What is deferred consideration? How is it different from contingent consideration? Contingent consideration, you don't know whether this consideration will be paid or not, because the payment of that consideration depends on an uncertain future event. But deferred consideration is not like that. Today I don't have sufficient money, so I will make the payment to you a year later or 5 years later. A part of consideration I'll pay now, a part is deferred to 2 years later. So that means I'm determining the consideration. It is not dependent on uncertain future event, but it is payable not today, but this part of consideration is payable after a specific period. This is called as deferred consideration. Whenever this concept of deferred consideration comes in, I'll have to apply the concept of time value into it. So therefore, in measurement of purchase consideration on the date of acquisition, I will measure this deferred consideration at its present value and include it in computation of PC. What did he write? An acquirer shall recognize the present value of the deferred consideration as a part of consideration transferred in exchange of acquiry. Acquirer shall recognize the finance expense in P&L related to the deferred consideration. What is finance cost? Because you are discounting it to the present value, every year there should be an interest catch up. That interest catch up, the acquirer will recognize it as a finance cost in your P&L. Clear? Now guys, why should I talk about goodwill? Go up above. When you did your net assets method, I said purchase consideration is equal to assets minus outside liabilities plus goodwill. So there plus goodwill, that means goodwill has to be identified. It has to be determined. So what are the methods in determining goodwill and what is goodwill will be our next discussion. Yes, guys. So let's get into this concept of goodwill valuation. What is goodwill and why do they value goodwill? How is the goodwill being valued? See, goodwill is an intangible asset, but at the time of acquisition, I will always ascertain the value of goodwill to be included in the purchase consideration. Now, let's say for example, I am having a particular enterprise which is into manufacturing of steel. My today's capacity per day is to produce 8 metric tons of steel. That is my current production capacity, 8 metric tons of steel per day. I have sufficient demand outside for basically this purchase of 8 metric tons of steel. Today, a purchaser or an acquirer came up to me or approached me for buying the stake in my company. So I told him, these are my set of assets, these are my set of liabilities. He ascertained the net assets value as 150 crores. At this 150 crores, I will say, I will not sell you because this is the fair value of my assets and liabilities. What is the value for my existing production facility? My existing production facility of 8 metric tons, finding a customer is not easy. If you put up your same 150 crores and start put up your new plant, it will take you at least 3 years for you to reach 8 metric ton capacity. So therefore, there should be a value which is attached to that. He'll say that is qualitative in nature. So let's quantify this. This quantification of abnormal or higher profits to your enterprise is called as goodwill. So goodwill can be given with an expression as an excess earning capacity of an enterprise in future. It is an excess earning capacity of an enterprise in future. If an enterprise has a capacity to earn in future, then you can definitely say that yes. So if an enterprise has an excess earning capacity in future, it should be called as goodwill. Now, what is your excess earning capacity? How do I calculate it? How do I measure it? This excess earning capacity measurement is given with a word called as goodwill. So how do I determine goodwill? Let's see. So when I talk about goodwill determination, it is future excess earning capacity of an enterprise, which can be determined by 4 methods: average profit method, super profit method, annuity method, and capitalization method. Well, let's quickly go through what these 4 methods are. The 3 determinants of goodwill, which I always need, are number 1, future maintainable profit. I'm saying the 3 determinants of goodwill are future maintainable profits. Let me write down. My determinants of goodwill are predominantly 3 things. 1, 2, 3. First one called as future maintainable profits. In short, we call it as FMP. Future maintainable profits, in short called as FMP. Second one, average capital employed. Average capital employed. Third one is NRR. Whenever I say NRR, NRR is always given as a percentage. And this NRR is generally industry specific. It is industry specific. So it depends upon the industry to which I'm actually determining goodwill. Let's say I'm determining goodwill with respect to an enterprise which is in the industry of technology. So my NRR will be different. Let's say an enterprise which is in the industry of steel manufacture is trying to determine goodwill. their NRR will be different. Let's say I'm looking at enterprise, which is in the industry of FMCG, fast moving consumer goods. NRR is slightly different. So you need to understand that NRR depends upon the industry to which the enterprise belongs, based on which the NRR should be determined. Guys, in general sense, when I try to determine NRR, I will always use the logics of Ashwadamodaran. He is an author, Ashwadamodaran. He will basically give you NRR of various industries. You can basically log into nye.edu. So that is where he basically gives you all this information. So he is a very renowned guy. You can search him on Google. We normally use NRR of that particular person, Ashwadamodaran, who will give us the industry-based NRRs. Clear? Moving. That is too much into practical sense. Push it aside. Industry-specific value. How do I determine average capital employed? To determine my average capital employed, I'll go like this. My average capital employed is equal to my opening capital plus closing capital divided by 2, or I'll use the formula closing capital employed minus half of current year profit after tax. Opening capital, closing capital employed minus half of current year profit after tax. Either of these formulas shall be applied in determining what is average capital. Now, capital employed, you're saying, what is capital employed? Capital employed is nothing but your value of net assets. So if I want to determine the value of capital employed, I'll again use the formula assets minus outside liabilities. Remember, when I say this, assets should always be valued at their realizable values, and liabilities should always be measured. Your liabilities should always be measured at their settlement values. Right, sir. Very good, sir. I just did not even realize that my meetings got shut down, sir.
Oh, okay.
So yes, guys, I was talking about your determination of goodwill, and I said there are three determinants: FMP, future maintainable profits, average capital employed, and NRR. What is your NRR? It is an industry specific number. So it depends to which industry the enterprise belongs to. NRR will be depending on that. What is your average capital employed? Opening capital plus closing capital divided by 2, or closing capital minus half of current year profit after tax. What is capital employed? Capital employed is nothing but assets minus outside liabilities, where all assets should be measured at their realizable values and their liabilities should be measured at settlement values. The liabilities should be measured at settlement values. Now, whenever I say this logic, remember, while considering my assets, I particularly exclude my non-operating assets, which are not held for operating purposes, investments in fixed deposits, they are non-operating assets. Number two, and my fictitious assets. What do you mean by fictitious assets? Fictitious assets are miscellaneous expenses not written off. Such kind of assets do not have realizable values. In this case, the realizable value is equal to zero. Since they don't have realizable value, there is no point of including them in computation of net assets or capital employed. But if I talk about your future maintainable profits on how to determine, future maintainable profits should always be determined with the help of average of past profits. Average of past profits adjusted by plus some growth. Last year I made a profit of so much, that average plus the growth which I am expecting to have. Now, whenever I say average, then the question comes up, should I consider a weighted average or should I consider a simple average? It depends upon the past profits. If the past profits of the enterprise either show an increasing trend or a decreasing trend, then it is advisable for the average to be considered as a weighted average. If the past profits either show an increasing trend or show a decreasing trend, it is always advisable to use weighted average. If there is no trend, no increase, no decreasing trend, in such cases, I will use simple average of past profits to determine your FMP. While we are trying to measure our past profits, our past profits should always exclude extraordinary items, winning from lottery due to COVID, 3 months got shut down. That is extraordinary. Number two, non-operating expenses and non-operating incomes. I have investment in fixed deposit. That investment derived some interest income. Such interest on fixed deposit should not be considered as an average of past profits. In computation of past profit, this is non-operating in nature, which should be excluded. Profit or loss from sale of asset, extraordinary. You will sell assets every day. Your fixed assets are there. They are meant for use. You have sold it during a particular year. You derive some gain or loss. That is an extraordinary item, should not be considered in computation of past profits for determining FMP. Clear? Now, let's get back to what we were discussing. Valuation of goodwill. We just saw three determinants. Using these three determinants, how do I value goodwill? Average profit method. It is nothing but goodwill is equal to FMP into number of years purchase. How do you determine FMP? FMP is determined based on past profits, where they excludes abnormal gains and losses, non-operating incomes and expenses. What is your number of years purchase? The number of years for which the enterprise is expected to derive such profit. The number of years for which the enterprise is expected to derive such excess profit is called as number of years purchase. So the number of years purchase into your future maintainable profits is called as goodwill under average profit method. Guys, if you again go back to the definition of goodwill, what did the goodwill define as? Future excess earning capacity. But if you look at this formula, FMP into number of years purchased, where is the concept of excess earnings? You just took whatever earning I'll do tomorrow, multiplied by number of years. That's it. The concept of excess earning has not been incorporated into this. That is the reason why, to correct it, he came up with something called as super profit method. Where under super profit method, goodwill is equal to super profit into number of years purchased. What is super profit? Excess profit. What is the excess profit? FMP, future maintainable profit, minus my normal profit. How do you get normal profit? Normal profit means, if my average capital employed is 100 and if my NRR of the industry is 12%, then normal profit is 12. If my maintainable profits in future are 15, then I am expected to get an excess earning of 3 rupees every year. That 3 rupees is called as super profit. So to calculate super profit, it should be FMP minus normal profit. Future maintainable profits minus normal profit. I know how to determine FMP, which is average of past profits plus growth rate. But whenever I talk about normal profit is nothing but average capital employed into NRR, which is represented as a percentage. We've already discussed just now how to calculate average profits. Average capital employed is equal to opening capital employed plus closing capital employed divided by 2. What is annuity method? Annuity method is a further development over super profits method. Because what are you saying, super profits method? This much excess profit I will earn for the future 5 years. Guys, it's a future cost. Future profit, today you are assessing. If you are today assessing what is a future profit, on today's date, I'll have to apply the present value factors. So that super profit, instead of being multiplied by number of years purchase, if I consider the time value of money and multiply it with PVAF, that will give me goodwill as per annuity method. The last one where I identify goodwill as per capitalization method, I will forget about this concept of number of years purchase. I'll simply say goodwill is equal to your normal capital minus average capital. How do I get normal capital employed? Normal capital employed is equal to FMP by NRR. It is FMP by NRR. Alternatively, goodwill can be calculated as super profits divided by NRR also. Both formulas should derive the same answer. Either you do normal capital minus average capital, or you do super profit divided by NRR, you should be deriving at the same answer for goodwill. Clear? That will bring us to the end of discussions regarding goodwill valuation. Moving further, what about direct cost of acquisition? For any acquisition to happen, or for any merger to happen, for any business combination to occur, multiple costs are involved. I'll first identify a valuation officer. He is called as registered valuation officer, or can be called also as merchant bankers. These people get involved in determining the value of the company. This determination of value of the company will come at a cost. Some cost has to be incurred. Legal documents have to be drafted. Legal documents like share transfer agreement, your term sheet, all these have to be drafted by technical subject matter experts, which also comes at a particular cost. Additional shares should be issued. To issue the additional shares, authorized capital should be increased. Authorized capital increase will give rise to stamp duty, which is also a cost incident. These are costs which are directly associated to acquisition. Whoever incurs it, if the acquiree incurs it or the acquirer incurs it, it should be charged off to P&L. It should never be included in purchase consideration. It should never be included in purchase consideration. Clear? Yes, guys, what is the concept of demerger and why does it occur? Guys, demerger in the sense where, let's say for example, I am involved in, let's say I am Raymond's Industry. Okay, Raymond's is into cloth and also makes ready-made garments. My cloth is known to be one of the premium cloths or fine cloths, fine clothing. I also produce ready-made garments. These are two distinct businesses for me. If you talk about IND-AS 108 operating segments, both should be considered as two different business cycles, two different operating segments. Over a period of time, I understood that both of them are equally doing good. So what I thought was, let us make the ready-made garments into a separate company as such, and let's try to market that separate company again. So instead of Raymond's, I wanted to create something else. I want to name it something else and I wanted to make sure that it was continued. So this way, out of my existing business, one of the division has got demerged, has emerged into in the form of a new company altogether. So the net assets of the demerged division get transferred to the new company. That new company is going to pay purchase consideration either to the original company or to the shareholders of the original company directly. This is a simple case of demerger. This is what I have represented as far as your the sheet is concerned or the presentation is concerned. A has two divisions, X and Y. The Y division will get transferred to B Limited, where B Limited issues purchase consideration either directly to A Limited or can issue to the shareholders of A Limited. In such case, the acquiree company or the selling company, in this case, is A Limited. What is the entry they have to record? They'll have to derecognize the net assets of Y division. So two net assets and debit whatever purchase consideration they receive from the acquirer should be debited, credit the net assets of the division which is transferred. The balance of this entry or the difference of this entry should be transferred to other equity. I will debit purchase consideration only if the consideration is received by A Limited. In this case, I clearly told you the purchase consideration can either be paid to A Limited or can be paid to the shareholders of A Limited. If the consideration is not paid to A Limited, but instead directly paid to the shareholders, then the debit will not be given to purchase consideration. In such case, I will only credit the net asset and the entire book value of the net assets will be transferred to other equity. So I'll record the entry as other equity account debit or retained earnings account debit to net assets. Clear? Acquirer company who is taking over the net assets of the demerged division, I will record the net assets taken over at their fair value. So net assets account debit to purchase consideration which is transferred. Now, unlike the acquiree, where I will basically, the difference of the entry is adjusted to other equity. In this case, the difference of the entry should be adjusted to either goodwill or capital reserve. Please make sure that you're checking the entries. Please make sure that you check the entries, guys. Like I told you, please observe the entries very carefully, what are being passed. Why is it debited to the net assets? Why is it credited to the net assets in books of inquiry and acquirer are really important to understand. Now, there is one concept of statutory reserve which I have to tell. Statutory reserve should be created in compliance to a law, like investment allowance reserve, export profit reserves, and development rebate reserves. The peculiar nature of these reserves is that the reserve shall exist irrespective of the corporate restructuring process. That means you can do any business acquisition possible. It could be an amalgamation, it could be an absorption, it is only business combination, you do whatever. Irrespective of the process of corporate restructuring you do, this reserve has to appear again in the books of purchasing company or the acquirer company. So therefore, when the IND AS 103, when it talks about acquisition method, the reserves of the acquiring company are not taken over. What I take over is only the net assets. That is the reason why it requests or it requires us to pass an additional entry in the books of acquirer. The acquirer will now recognize an entry as amalgamation adjustment to statutory reserve. That is an extra entry which the acquirer has to record because this reserve should appear irrespective of corporate restructuring process. If there is an absorption which happens, that means let's say X is absorbing Y Limited. Y Limited is liquidated. If Y Limited has that statutory reserve, it should appear in the books of X Limited as well. In the books of X Limited, since I don't take over the reserves of Y Limited, I'll have to create an additional entry called as amalgamation adjustment account debit to statutory reserve. That is the last topic before I get into concentration test. We have already discussed this concentration test. It is only an optional test for a simplified assessment of whether the set of activities acquired is an asset or a business. Now, it is met, a concentration test is met if substantially all the fair value of the gross assets acquired is concentrated in single identifiable asset or a group of similar assets. That means if your part A, fair value of gross assets acquired, is substantially equal or substantially concentrated in part B, that is the fair value of single identifiable asset or group of similar asset, then you can say that the concentration test is met. If the concentration test is met, then you will say that it is only an acquisition of asset. It is not an acquisition of business. Your concentration test excludes cash and cash equivalents, deferred tax, and goodwill. It includes any consideration transferred in excess of fair value of net assets acquired. A single identifiable asset shall include any asset or group of assets that would be recognized and measured as single identifiable asset in a business combination. If a tangible asset is attached to and cannot be physically removed from another tangible asset without significant cost or diminution in utility or fair value, then those assets should be considered as single identifiable asset. When assessing whether the assets are similar, the entity should consider the nature of each single identifiable asset, risk associated to managing and creating the output from those assets. What are the steps? Measure the fair value of gross assets acquired, identify the single identifiable asset, and determine if substantially all the fair value is concentrated in the value determined as per part B. Clear? Few assets are not supposed to be considered as similar. What are those assets which should not be considered as similar? A tangible and an intangible asset are not similar assets. A tangible asset in different class unless they are considered as single identifiable asset in accordance with criteria D. The criteria D is nothing but the point number 4, where it is attached to and cannot be physically removed without separating from the other tangible asset, without incurring significant cost or significant diminution in value of utility, then the asset should be considered as single identifiable asset. So assets of different class should be considered as single identifiable asset if they satisfy point D. Otherwise, they should be considered as separate assets. Identified intangible assets of different classes. One is a license, other one is a patent. These are assets of different classes of intangible asset cannot be considered as single identifiable asset. A financial asset cannot be identified together with a non-financial asset as a single identifiable asset. Inventory and receivables. Inventory, non-financial. Receivables, that is nothing but debtors. They are financial in nature. They cannot be considered as a single identifiable asset. Identifiable assets that are within the same class but have significantly different risk characters. So it could be a similar asset, same machinery, but the other machinery is subjected to significant risk. Let's say I have one machine somewhere in Bangalore, one machinery which is sitting right on the shore in Chennai. The machinery is made of steel, so the machinery in Chennai is more subjected to corrosion due to the humidity in the environment. So therefore, there is a subjected to different risk classification. They cannot be classified as single identifiable asset. And that will bring us to the end of the topic, IND AS 103.